Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel Network Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. Wisdom is understanding God's Word. Pastor Murray's unique teaching approach brings God's Word alive with meaning as he takes you on a chapter-by-chapter, verse-by-verse study of God's letter to you, the Bible. And now, here is Pastor Dennis Murray.
Good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Ready to get back into our Father's Word here at the chapel? We invite you to get your Bible and join us if you care to. We're going to pick it up today, 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 22. In our last lecture, we saw Jehu anointed the king over Israel. And you see, Joram thinks he's still the king of Israel. That's a fixing to change in our lesson today. And Joram, now remember, he's the son of Ahab and Jezebel. So we got some pretty rotten stock that he comes from. Then you've got, he was wounded when he was in war, and he went back to Jezreel to recover of his wounds that he suffered fighting against the Syrians. And Ahaziah, his nephew, is the king of Judah. At the time, he's the grandson of Ahab and Jezebel, and we've got a pretty fine pair. His mother is Athaliah, if that tells you anything. So both of some pretty rotten stock. But Ahaziah is at Jezreel visiting Joram, and Jehu comes riding hard toward Jezreel, and a watchman saw his company and told Joram there's riders coming. And Joram sent out a horseman to inquire, is it peace, of Jehu. Jehu said to the first messenger, what peace, turn behind me and follow me, in other words. Joram sent out another messenger and asked of Jehu, is it peace? And Jehu once again said, what peace? And you turn behind me as well. And the watchtower men said, you know, I don't think either one of those messengers are coming back. And it appears that they joined Jehu. Well, Joram and Ahaziah got their chariots ready, and they're going out to meet Jehu as he comes. Let's see what Jehu and Joram and Ahaziah have to say to each other. Prophecy is about to be fulfilled. Let's pick it up then. We ask that word of wisdom in Yeshua's precious name. Father, we ask you to open eyes, open ears this day. 2 Kings chapter 9, verse 22, and it reads, and it came to pass when Joram saw Jehu that he said, is it peace, Jehu? And he answered, what peace? So long as the whoredoms of thy mother Jezebel and her witchcrafts are so many. And Jehu certainly isn't sugarcoating anything, is he? And he's telling it like it is concerning Jezebel. Jezebel, you remember, not even of Israel. She's from Zidon. Her father was the king of Zidon, and he was also a priest of Baal. Jezebel had done all she could to exterminate the worship of the true God of heaven and earth and had installed all kinds of Baal prophets. Verse 23, and Joram turned his hands. At this time they held the reins to the chariot in their hands, and to turn the hand mean to either to the right or left means to turn the chariot around, and fled. He's running for his life. And said to Ahaziah, his nephew, there is treachery, O Ahaziah. They've betrayed us, Ahaziah. And Jehu drew a bow with his full strength. And remember, Jehu is a seasoned combat soldier. You don't want to go messing with a seasoned combat soldier. But Jehu drew a bow with his full strength and smote Jehoram between his arms, between the shoulder blades, in other words. And the arrow went out at his heart, and he sunk down in his chariot. God's judgment carried out. You remember Elijah told Ahab that he and every male in his family were going to be exterminated. Verse 25. And now we just have one king of Israel. Then said Jehu to Bidkar, his captain, take up and cast him, speaking of Joram, in the portion of the field of Naboth the Jezreelite. For remember how that when I and thou rode together after Ahab his father, we were both serving in the military under King Ahab, the Lord laid his burden upon him. Again, this prophetic pronouncement of Elijah was going to come to pass. You see, Naboth was an innocent landowner in the area of Jezreel. The only thing, unfortunately, that was unlucky for him was that his property was adjacent to Ahab's. And Ahab coveted Naboth's vineyard. And he tried to talk him into trading, first of all, the property for another piece of property or selling it. And you don't sell your inheritance in the promised land. Well, Naboth refused. Jezebel made up a false report, and the people of Jezreel murdered, set up a kangaroo court, and then they murdered Naboth and his sons and took his vineyard. The prophecy at the time, just as the dogs that licked up the blood of Naboth in his vineyard, they would also lick up the blood of Ahab in the same place. Verse 26, surely I have seen yesterday the blood of Naboth and the blood of his sons. In 1 Kings 21:13, the sons weren't stated, but Jezebel and Ahab had to kill Naboth's sons or else they would have inherited his vineyard. Now there was no one to inherit, saith the Lord, and I will requite or repay thee in this plat, in this portion of land, saith the Lord. Now therefore take and cast him into the plat of ground according to the word of the Lord. 1 Kings 21:19. And in the place where the dogs licked up the blood of Naboth, they would lick up the blood of Ahab as well. And you might say, well, wait a minute. I thought Joram was the one that Jehu killed. Well, remember, Joram is the son of Ahab. So whose blood runs through the veins of Jehoram? Of course, Ahab and Jezebel. The dogs are going to lick up the blood of Ahab in Naboth's vineyard. Verse 27. But when Ahaziah, the king of Judah, saw this, he fled by the way of the garden house, and Jehu followed after him, and said, smite him also in the chariot. And they did so at the going up to Gur, which is by Ibleam, and he fled to Megiddo and died there. Megiddo, the place, Armageddon, we get a little peek maybe into the future there, the gathering place of the crowd, 28. And his servants carried him, his corpse, in other words, of Ahaziah, in a chariot to Jerusalem, and buried him in his sepulcher with his fathers in the city of David. Now, Jerusalem, of course, being the city of David. I don't think David would have been very proud of Ahaziah. And was David perfect? Well, far from it. David did many things but any man king is going to fall short. But one thing David never did was fall into idolatry, which is what Ahaziah did. He learned a lot from his grandfather and his grandmother, Ahab and Jezebel. Verse 29, and in the 11th year of Joram, the son of Ahab, began Ahaziah to reign over Judah, and he reigned 1 year. Wait till you see who's next. Verse 30. And when Jehu was come to Jezreel, Jezebel heard of it. And when she heard of it, she heard of the death of her son Joram and grandson Ahaziah. And she painted her face and tired her head. This means she adorned her head and looked out at a window. She fixed herself up, I think trying to look intimidating to Jehu. Jehu's not one to intimidate, though. But she's trying to impose a look that would look like she's in control, is what this is talking about, that she made herself up with paint, much as a woman might make herself up with makeup today, and adorned her hair. What will Jehu have to say to Jezebel? And as Jehu entered in at the gate, she said, "Had Zimri peace, who slew his master?" Now, this is pretty bold of Jezebel, knowing that Jehu has killed her son and her grandson. Zimri, you may recall in 1 Kings chapter 16, Zimri killed Elah, the son of Baasha, and took the throne of Israel. That's what she's talking about. Zimri slew his master to take the throne. And she's accusing Jehu of murdering Joram, his master, in her eyes, to take his throne as well. Verse 32, "And he," Jehu, "lifted up his face to the window and said, 'Who is on my side?'" Who? Question. "And there looked out to him two or three eunuchs," or chamberlains, you could think of them. And, you know, I can't imagine what it would have been like to work under Jezebel. I can imagine that those who did weren't very fond of her as well. We're going to see this to be the case, that Jehu is going to instruct them to basically throw Jezebel to her death, her former students. Servants, 33. "And he said, 'Throw her down.' So they threw her down, and some of her blood was sprinkled on the wall and on the horses, and he," being Jehu, "trode her underfoot." Jehu would have the chariot wheels and the horse hooves, and basically drove them back and forth over Jezebel until she was dead. "And when he was come in, he did eat and drink," time to refresh himself. He's been a busy young man with all that's gone on this day. "And said, 'Go see now this cursed woman and bury her, for she is a king's daughter.'" Now, Jehu knew the prophecy well enough to know that Jezebel was not going to be buried. Elijah at the same time said that the blood of Ahab will be lapped up by the dogs in Naboth's vineyard. Basically in the same breath said Jezebel will be eaten by dogs in the city of Jezreel. That will come to pass. When he said she is a king's daughter, she was the daughter of Ethbaal, the king of Zidon. Verse 35, "And they went to bury her, but they found no more of her than a skull and the feet and the palms of her hands," all that was left. Basically, those parts, not much meat on them, and the dogs wouldn't be interested in any of those. And some might say, well, boy, this seems awfully rough and mean to Jezebel. Well, I don't know if you think that this was undeserved punishment for Jezebel. I think you missed the last several chapters of 1 Kings. You see, Jezebel, as I said earlier, was killing all the prophets, true prophets of the Lord, and she was installing her own prophets. And then there was the matter of Naboth and his sons. And she set them up and had them murdered so that her husband could have his vineyard. Verse 36, Wherefore they came again and told him, these are the ones he told to go and see about this cursed woman. And he said, this is the word of the Lord which he spake by his servant Elijah the Tishbite, saying, in the portion of Jezreel shall dogs eat the flesh of Jezebel. The prophecies of the Lord through his true prophets always come to pass, exactly as they're spoken, exactly as they're written. Verse 37, and the carcass of Jezebel shall be as dung upon the face of the field in the portion of Jezreel, so that they shall not say, this is Jezebel. In other words, they won't be able to even recognize Jezebel to say, this is Jezebel. Well, there's still some of Ahab's family, males. The prophecy of Elijah was that every male of the descendants of Ahab was going to be exterminated. Well, Jehu has some more work ahead of him. Chapter 10, verse 1. And Ahab had 70 sons in Samaria. And this is the capital of the 10 northern tribes. And Jehu wrote letters and sent to Samaria unto the rulers of Jezreel, to the elders, and to them that brought up Ahab's children, saying, this brought up in the Hebrew is nourishers of Ahab's children. Now, we're not talking about Ahab's actual sons and daughters. He has one daughter left, Athaliah, as we'll see, but these are grandsons and great-grandsons. When it said 70 sons in Samaria, in the Hebrew, there is no word for grandson or grandfather. So all the descendants of Ahab would be called sons, even though they're grandsons and great-grandsons. Now, something seems strange here. Why would Jehu be writing letters to the rulers of Jezreel and sending them to Samaria? Well, you see, the rulers of Jezreel were guilty of the kangaroo court and the murder of Naboth. They're hearing about anyone who had anything to do with Naboth's murder being dead themselves. So they ran to Samaria seeking protection, is what's going on here. Verse 2. Now as soon as this letter cometh to you, seeing your master's sons, speaking of Ahab, are with you, and there are with you chariots and horses, a fenced city also, and armor. You've got 70 descendants of Ahab. Probably not one of them had ever done a day's work in their life. You talk about a silver spoon-fed generation or two, the descendants of Ahab would fit. And Jehu's a pretty smart cookie. We're going to see what he's doing here is finding out what is in the heads and the hearts of the rulers of Jezreel. Are they going to support these sons of Ahab as king of Israel, or are they going to support him, as Jehu speaking, as the king of Israel? But he's being a little sarcastic here. He said, you have 70 of Ahab's descendants. You pick out the best one and put him on the throne and fight for him. Verse 3. Look even out the best, seek out the best, and meetest of your master's sons, and set him on his father's throne, and fight for your master's house. Pick the best one, make him your king, and then you fight for him. And you understand, Jehu is a seasoned combat soldier. These rulers of Jezreel are afraid of him, obviously, because they fled to Samaria for protection when they found out anybody that had anything to do with Naboth's murder was dead themselves. Jehu seeing what's in their hearts and in their head. Verse 4. But they were exceedingly afraid and said, Behold, two kings stood not before him. How then shall we stand? Jehu killed Joram and Ahaziah. How are we going to stand against him? They're reasoning among themselves. Verse 5. And he that was over the house, and he that was over the city, the elders also, and the bringers up of the children, sent to Jehu, saying, they were all in agreement, We are thy servants, and will do all that thou shalt bid us. We will not make any king. Do thou that which is good in thine eyes. Mission accomplished. Jehu has established where the hearts of the rulers of Jezreel are. Who are they going to support? Verse 6. Then he wrote a letter the second time to them, saying, If ye be mine, in the Hebrew is if you are for me, and if you will hearken unto my voice, take ye the heads of the men, your master's sons, the 70 sons of Ahab mentioned in verse 1, and come to me to Jezreel by tomorrow this time. Now the king's sons, being 70 persons, were with the great men of the city, which brought them up, all descendants of Ahab. And the prophecy of Elijah was not one of the males of Ahab's house was to survive. Verse 7, And it came to pass, when the letter came to them, that they took the king's sons, and slew 70 persons, and put their heads in baskets, and sent him them to Jezreel. So much for their loyalty to the house of Ahab. I guess they thought better the 70 sons of Ahab's heads than our own. Verse 8. And there came a messenger and told him, him being Jehu, saying, They have brought the heads of the king's sons. And he said, Lay ye them in two heaps at the entering in of the gate until the morning. Now this would be very effective. You see, the gate of the city, obviously, where anyone who was coming or leaving would go through the gate. And Jehu's instructed him, you take 35 heads of the sons of Ahab and put them on one side of the gate and 35 heads on the other side of the gate. This would make a pretty strong point to the people of Jezreel what was going on. Verse 9. And it came to pass in the morning that he went out and stood, this is Jehu, and said to all the people of Jezreel, You be righteous. Behold, I conspired against my master. I killed Joram and slew him. But who slew all of these? Referring to the 35 heads on one side of the gate and 35 heads on the other side of the gate. He's pretty sharp cookie here. He's saying, you know, I killed my master Joram, but you all are just as guilty in this conspiracy to overthrow the monarchy as I am, because you killed these 70 descendants of Ahab. Verse 10. Know now that there shall fall unto the earth nothing of the word of the Lord. This meaning that there will nothing that comes from the mouth of the Lord remain unfulfilled. Jehu may not have everything right. He's got that right. Which the Lord spake concerning the house of Ahab. For the Lord hath done that which he spake by his servant Elijah. 1 Kings chapter 21, verse 21 and the following verse. The desired effect, he would now slay Ahab's family while they quietly watched. There's still more of Ahab's family left. Verse 11. So Jehu slew all that remained of the house of Ahab in Jezreel, and all his great men, all of his counselors, and his kinsfolks, and his priests, until he left him none remaining. And here he's eliminating any possibility of kinsman redeemer rights. I think Jehu's motives might be a bit political here too. He got a little more carried away in the execution of God's judgment than what God's judgment actually was. You see, it was the descendants of Ahab who were to die, not necessarily priests. This is not Baal priest, but probably court priest, his advisors, his counselors. But he's eliminating all of anyone who might have somewhat of an axe to grind with Jehu for what he did to the house of Ahab. Maybe a little bit of a political motive here. Verse 12, and he arose and departed and came to Samaria. And as he was at the shearing house in the way, he probably stopped there to rest a little bit, Jehu met with the brethren of Ahaziah, king of Judah, and said, who are ye? And they answered, we are the brethren of Ahaziah. And you know him, the king of Judah. What they're doing here is they see some men, Jehu and his, that look pretty rough, the military types. So they're dropping names, saying, you know, yeah, we're the relatives of king of Judah, Ahaziah. And we go down to salute the children of the king, referring, excuse me, to Joram, and the children of the queen, Jezebel. You see, they don't know that Ahaziah, Joram, and Jezebel are all dead at this point. And, you know, being a relative of Ahaziah, king of Judah, and Joram, king of Israel, and Jezebel was probably a good thing in most circles. Today, for them, not so much. Verse 14. And he said, Jehu, take them alive. And they took them alive and slew them at the pit of the shearing house, even 42 men. Neither left he any of them. 42 in biblical numerics is generation. The generation of Ahab and Jezebel is being wiped out. Verse 15. And when he was departed thence, he lighted or found on Jehonadab, the son of Rechab, coming to meet him. And he saluted him or blessed him and said to him, is thine heart right as my heart is with thy heart? In other words, are you honorable? And Jehonadab answered, it is. If it be, give me thine hand. And he gave him his hand and took him up to him into the chariot. Now, Rechab, if anyone who's studied with the chapel any length of time, you know the house of Rechab. We're talking Kenites here. 1 Chronicles chapter 2, verse 55. Will document that the house of Rechab are Kenites. You know, in Jeremiah chapter 35, Jeremiah mentioned the house of Rechab. And, you know, he complimented the Kenites, actually, Jeremiah did. He said, you know, you lead a simple nomadic life with no agricultural pursuits. Why? Because the ground was cursed that she would not produce her fruit to the Kenites from the time of Cain on down. The thing that Jeremiah complimented them about, he said, you know, I wish the children of God, the Yahweh, would follow his instructions as well as the Kenites follow their father's instructions. For they said to drink no alcohol, and they drank no alcohol. But the whole lesson here, and I think the reason this is inserted here was to watch who you have in your vehicle. He's welcoming Kenites aboard his chariot. And he said, come with me and see my zeal for the Lord. So they made him ride in his chariot. And we see a little bit of an ego on the part of Jehu. He didn't say, come and see the power of Almighty God. He said, come and see my zeal for the Lord. And in other words, come and witness my zeal for the Lord. And his zeal for the Lord is not all that pure, we'll see when we get to verse 29 and the following verses. Verse 17. And when he came to Samaria, this is Jehu and his Kenite friend, he slew all that remained unto Ahab in Samaria, till he had destroyed him according to the saying of the Lord, which he spake to Elijah, completely and utterly wiping out the descendants of Ahab. Every male descendant of Ahab was to be exterminated. Now Jehu sets his sights on the Baal worshipers that followed Ahab. Verse 18. And Jehu gathered all the people together and said unto them, Ahab served Baal a little, but Jehu shall serve him much. Again, we see what a sharp cookie Jehu was. He's falsely claiming that he's going to serve Baal much because he's getting ready to have a revival for the Baal worshipers. His intent to kill every single one of them. Verse 19. Now therefore call unto me all the prophets of Baal, all his servants, and all his priests, the all stated three times for emphasis. Let none be wanting or lacking, for I have a great sacrifice to do to Baal. Whosoever shall be wanting, he shall not live. But Jehu did it in subtlety to the intent that he might destroy the worshipers of Baal. The sacrifice that he's about to make to Baal, all of the prophets, all of the priests, all of the servants of Baal. Jehu's doing a good job. He's had a busy day, or 2 days. He's taking care of business, though. He's accomplishing a lot and fulfilling a lot of the prophecies of Elijah the prophet concerning the house of Ahab and Jezebel. We've got a short message. We'll come back and see in our next lecture how this works out. We got a short message. We'll ask you to listen a moment, won't you please?
The Mark of the Beast on CD is our free introductory offer to you. What is the Mark of the Beast? Many false teachers would have you believe it will be a tattoo on your forehead or a computer chip implanted under your skin. It's getting late in the game. You need to know what the Mark of the Beast is. As it's written in Revelation chapter 13, verse 8, many will be deceived. Christ said in Mark 13, 23, Behold, I have foretold you all things. Jesus indeed told us how not to be deceived, and Pastor Arnold Murray takes you on a step-by-step study of God's Word concerning this critical subject. The telephone call is free, the CD is free, no shipping and handling. Just call 800-643-4645 to request your one-time, one-per-household copy of The Mark of the Beast. You may also mail your request to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Don't be deceived by Satan.
Welcome back. We're glad you could join back with us. Let's have the 800 number, please. 800-643-4645. That number good throughout Puerto Rico, the U.S., and Canada. If you have a biblical question that you'd like to pose to possibly be answered on the air, feel free to call that 800 number and leave your question. I say possibly answered on the air. You know, this program goes into millions of homes around the world, and we just simply don't have time to get to all of the questions, but I do know this, if God wants your question to be on the program, it most certainly will. Please don't ask for a written response to your questions. The only format we have for answering questions is this right here on the air by one of the pastors. Please don't ask questions about a specific individual, denomination, or organization by name. We try to teach God's word in a positive format. Throwing out negative about others by name serves no purpose. We simply won't do it. If you're listening by shortwave radio or internet, studying via the internet somewhere around the world that's unable to use that 800 number, your announcer at the end of the hour will give you our mailing address. Quite all right to mail your questions in, being the point. Got a prayer request? You don't need a telephone number. We can do away with it. You don't need a mailing address. Your Heavenly Father is there for you day in and day out. I encourage you to talk to your Father. You know, I really feel like you don't have a lot of competition these days. It seems like everyone is so busy running here, running there. They don't have time for their Heavenly Father, and that's dangerous. If you don't have time for Him, guess what? He doesn't have any time for you either. You forsake Him, He will forsake you. Your relationship with your Heavenly Father doesn't depend on Him. It depends on you and you alone. We do have these prayer requests. Father, we come united as one in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask you to look upon these, Father. You know their needs, illnesses, Father. We ask for that touch of healing, addictions, Father. You know, if it is your will, a special blessing on each of these. And we lift up our military troops who are in harm's way around the world. Father, watch over, guide, protect, touch, heal in Jesus' precious name. Amen and thank you, Father. All right, let's get to some questions. Is it okay, it's from Sam in Illinois. Is it okay to smoke cigars? Well, smoking is unhealthy, and it's well documented that it causes cancer. Is it a sin? It is, but it is a sin against the flesh, such as is eating unclean foods. It's not a sin against your soul. And Beverly in Georgia, thank you for your program. I have learned so much from your method of teaching. Well, we're glad you enjoy the program. My question, where in the Bible can I find Noah's wife's name and genealogy? God bless you and the staff. Keep up the good work. And we intend to, and thank you for the encouragement. Beverly, you won't find Noah's wife's name written in the King James Version Bible. It's just not there. And of course, if her name's not there, her genealogy is not there either. You can be assured that she was Adamic. How so? Well, their children, the children of Noah and his wife, were Adamic. So Deborah in Georgia or California, are there going to be babies in heaven, or are we all the same age? We're all the same age in spiritual bodies, and the spiritual bodies, the messengers, the angels that God sent to earth were always young men, young adults. Some people say we're going to have a new name. It is written on a white stone. Will we have a new name and a new body? Well, we'll have a spiritual body, which you have your spiritual body now. It's just, it resides in your flesh body. And you're speaking of Revelation chapter 3, verse 12, the new name written. And those who overcome will have a new name. You'll find it in Isaiah chapter 62, verse 4. Those who don't worship the Antichrist or the bride of Christ, her name is Hephzibah, which in the Hebrew language means my delight is in her. And the exact scripture you were talking about, Revelation 2:17, also to him that overcometh, a new name written in a white stone, a new name which no man knoweth except him that receiveth it. So there it's saying that the name is only known by those who receive it. James in Michigan, Cain was not Abel's brother. Oh, but I'm reading chapter 4 in Genesis. It says Adam lay with his wife and she became pregnant and gave birth to Cain. She said, "With help of the Lord, I have brought forth a man." Then she gave birth to his brother Abel. I'd like to have verification on this, please. Cain and Abel were half brothers. They shared the same mother. And if you take, James, if you take Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, back to the original Hebrew language, what you said is true. Adam knew his wife. What it doesn't say there is she had already lain with the serpent in the garden, Genesis chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, and the Lord said, "Because of what you did, I'm going to greatly multiply your conception." Do you know what conception is and how one conceives, James? I don't think I need to explain it to you. What that's saying in Genesis chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, it states that Eve gave birth to Cain, and then again, and that word again should have been translated, she continued in labor and gave birth to Abel. So what you have is two children, they're twins, but they have different fathers. That's the reason you won't find Cain listed in Adam's genealogy in Genesis chapter 5. Why is Cain not there? Because he's not Adam's son. You find Cain's genealogy in Genesis chapter 4. It's quite different than Adam's. Pearl in Nevada. And thank you for your kind comments. What happened to Lazarus after he rose from the dead? Did he die again, or what did happen? Please reply. Well, it's not written, but it's only logical that he lived his life, out his life, as a normal person would. And yes, then he died again at a later point in time. George in West Virginia, where can I find about the horsemen of the Bible? Well, the word horseman appears over 40 times in the King James Version Bible. Please be a little more specific with your question. I'm going to guess that you're asking about the 200,000 horsemen of Revelation chapter 9, verse 16, and it is just a guess. These are the same that Gabriel and Michael fought against in Daniel chapter 10. It states that they have the breastplate on, but it's not the breastplate of the priest of Israel. They're the enemies of Israel. George in West Virginia, where in the Bible can I find about the fallen angels? Well, several places. Most notably, Genesis chapter 6, where the sons of God, those are angels, Job chapter 1, verse 6, will document that the sons of God are angels. But they came to earth, as it's written in Jude chapter 1, there's only one chapter, verse 6, that they left their habitation in heaven and came to earth. And they saw the daughters of Adam, and they took them to wife, and children were the result. They were abnormal, not natural giants, the Geber in the Hebrew language. If you have a companion Bible, check out Appendix 25, which is entitled Nethinim, and that's a Hebrew word that means fallen angels. There were three, actually, influxes of the fallen angels, Genesis chapter 6. There was a second influx in Genesis chapter 12 where they're called Canaanites, and there's a future influx of the fallen angels. It's when Michael boots Satan and those fallen angels out of heaven onto earth, Revelation chapter 12, verse 6, and the following verses. Romans, this is from Lorraine in North Carolina. Question, Romans 8:19. Who is the creature and why are they waiting for the manifesting of the sons of God? The above is my question. I watch your Bible study every morning. I've made a journal of the things you teach and am blessed by the teaching. Thank you. You're welcome. Well, the creation, the creature, I should say, of Romans chapter 8, verse 19, is God's creation. Probably would have been better translated, creation. And, you know, the earth awaits the manifesting of the Son of God, not the sons, plural, as you wrote, when Jesus Christ returns. Why? Because the earth is going to be, the creation, if you will, is going to be rejuvenated. There will be a new heaven and a new earth. Chester in Kansas, where is the verse about two candlesticks and the witnesses? And he's talking about the two witnesses, Revelation chapter 11, verse 1, and the following verses talk about the two witnesses. It tells us even how much longer they will be here than the Antichrist and what their powers will be. They're going to have pretty awesome powers at their disposal, the power of Almighty God. Willie in Maryland, please explain, let us make man. Was there someone else in the Garden of Eden? Well, God wasn't in the garden when he said, let us make man in our image. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26, God was in heaven, and when he said, let us make man in our image, the us he was talking to were the angels. You see, this earth age, the second earth and heaven age, when every creation of God, every soul, it was his plan, his intent, for each one to be born in the flesh one time. And like I said earlier, those fallen angels refused to be born of woman and came to earth. But that's what God was saying. He was, when he said, let us, he was talking of the angels. And if you're not in the flesh right now on earth, you're in a spiritual body with the Lord in heaven. Bob in New Jersey. If all the races were created on the sixth day and Adam and Eve on the eighth day, then why does everybody have to pay for the sin in the garden? Not everyone has to pay for the sin in the garden. Everyone is only accountable for the sins that they commit. You don't pay for it unless you commit it. But, you know, God made the law, and then when he made the law and gave commandments, it became law for everyone, including the six-day creation. So no law, no sin. But once the law was given, then everyone, no one's perfect. Everyone is accountable, though, for their own sins. And of course, today we're in the time period of the dispensation of grace. And what does that mean? That means that we can go to the Father with repentant heart and ask for forgiveness, and the slate is wiped clean. We're not held accountable for those sins we repent of. LJ in Michigan. And thank you for your kind comments. My questions. I thought your father spelled, and you have it YHVH, as YAHVEH. Please correct me if I'm wrong. YHVH is with the vowels missing, which was quite common in the Hebrew language. Both are correct. And then you have the follow with the second, and did Solomon write the Proverbs after he started worshiping other gods? And he did fall into idolatry because of his many foreign wives. He allowed them to set up altars all over Mount of Olives and Mount Zion, and he worshiped them. I believe Solomon wrote the Proverbs and Ecclesiastes before he started participating in idolatry. Joan in Massachusetts. We who are on earth in this second earth age, are we souls that followed Satan in the first earth age? I've never really heard a yes or no answer on this. Well, not necessarily is your answer. And I think you're confusing the third that followed Satan in the first earth age, possibly with the fallen angels, which is a common error. But not necessarily, you see, because two-thirds of God's children did not follow Satan in the first earth age. But all, again, it was God's intention that all would be born in the flesh one time, in this, the second earth and heaven age. Jennifer in Maine, thank you all and the staff. Thank you for remembering the staff. My son is 2.5 years old, and he would like to know if God sleeps. Okay, well, I certainly hope so, because I'll tell you, sleep is a big part of my life. But, you know, in a spiritual body, requires food, in that God gave the children of Israel manna, which is angels' food, as it's called in Psalms. I believe it's Psalm 78. But I sure hope that we sleep. Also, how do I answer this question of why he can't give God the picture he drew for him? I tried explaining the supernatural spiritual body to him and dimensions, but I could see I was losing him. Do you have an answer for this level? I would have taped that picture to the refrigerator, and I said, there it is. If God wants to look at it, and when God comes by, he can look at it and enjoy it. That's where we'll leave it, is right there on the refrigerator. Mark in Texas, we thank you, and thank you for your kind comments. Question Luke 21, verses 20 and 21. And when you shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know the desolation, desolator, you have Antichrist, is nigh. When Jerusalem is compassed with armies, is that now, or does it include all of the state of Israel yet future? And it's yet future. Zechariah chapter 14 is also a second witness to what you are reading there in Luke. Luke 21, 21, you follow, then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, referring to the second advent, second white hours rider Yeshua of Revelation 19, verse 11, and he that sat upon him was called faithful and true. Question, are those that are ordered to flee to the mountains the enemies of Christ, or are they his elect that Christ is trying to protect from his wrath? He's not trying to protect them from his, meaning God's, wrath. He's trying to protect them from the Antichrist, because that's what that's talking about in the earlier verses, when you see the desolator standing where he ought not, is the way Moffat translates, rather than where it ought not. In other words, Antichrist is going to be in Jerusalem claiming to be Jesus Christ. And that's when the elect should flee Judea. Oh, why? Because he's in control of Judea. Get out of Judea until it's time for us to be delivered up and witness. All on God's schedule. Pam in California, please explain resurrection. I don't understand what there is to be resurrected. Well, I think of resurrection on three different levels. When we as human beings first come to knowledge and believe on Jesus Christ, we're resurrected to a higher level of thinking. We want to do things right. We intuitively know what's right and what's wrong. Secondly, when we die, our soul or our spirit resurrects. And I think that might answer your question. You say, what is there to be resurrected? Of the flesh, there's nothing to be resurrected. It returns to the earth from which it came. Then on the soul, on the other hand, does resurrect and returns to Father from which it came. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verses 6 and 7. The third type of resurrection that I think of in God's Word, you'll read about in Revelation chapter 20, verses 5 and 6. Those who don't worship the Antichrist, that don't receive the mark of the beast, they reign with Christ 1,000 years, the millennium, and they also participate in the first resurrection. That means they're good to go into the eternity. The second death at that point, the death of the soul, has no power over them. All the rest, though, remain dead until the end of the millennium. I'm speaking spiritually dead, not the death of the flesh. David in Washington, it's awfully hard, it seems like, for some folks to separate flesh from spirit. David in Washington, where can I find Mary's lineage in the Bible? Well, you'll find the lineage, you can identify which tribe her mother was of in Luke chapter 1. Why? Because Elizabeth was her cousin. Their mother was of Levi. Mary's mother was of Levi. Luke chapter 3, Heli was Mary's father. He was of the tribe of Judah. The king line and the priest line came together. The word became flesh. I'm out of time. I love you all a great deal. Why? Because you enjoy studying our Father's word in depth. And you know what? It makes God's day. When he looks down and he sees you reading the letter that he wrote to you, blessings are going to follow. We are brought to you by your tithes and offerings. If we've helped you, help us keep coming to you and to reach out to others who are lost in this world of darkness. There's one thing most important, though, beloved. It's this. You stay in his word every day. Every day in your Father's word is a good day, even with trouble. You know why? Because Jesus is the living word.
Hearing God's word with understanding will change your life. We hope you have enjoyed studying God's Word here on the Shepherd's Chapel Family Bible Study Hour with Pastor Dennis Murray. If you would like to receive more information concerning Shepherd's Chapel, you may request our free introductory offer. Our introductory offer contains the Mark of the Beast CD, our monthly newsletter with a written Bible study, a CD catalog, and a list of written reference works available through Shepherd's Chapel. To request our free introductory offer by telephone, call 800-643-4645, 24 hours a day. You may also request our introductory offer by writing to Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. Once again, that's Shepherd's Chapel, P.O. Box 416, Gravette, Arkansas, 72736. We invite you to join us for the next in-depth Bible study each weekday at the same time. Thank you for watching today's program, and God bless you.
The Book of Ezekiel. What a fantastic study, this book of Ezekiel. The book of Ezekiel that covers, if you would, those vehicles, those circular discs. In the Hebrew, it states very clearly that that whirlwind with the color amber traced back to the Hebrew, highly polished bronze. What an exciting thing that God's word informs us on all things. Ezekiel, one of my favorite prophets of the Bible, probably more written, not probably, but absolutely more written on what will happen in the millennium age than even the book of Revelation. Ezekiel guiding you through it, what God will expect at the final battle, Armageddon and Hamagog, recorded in this great prophecy. I know you're going to enjoy it, the book of Ezekiel.
Rabat, Arkansas, this is Shepherd's Chapel with Pastor Arnold Murray. Join with us now as Pastor Murray takes you on a book-by-book, chapter-by-chapter, line-by-line study of God's Word. Now, here is Pastor Murray.
All right, good day to you. God bless you. Welcome to the Shepherd's Chapel. Welcome to this Family Bible Study Hour. Praise God, we're ready to get back into our Father's Word. The two brothers, what an interesting study. Those brothers from Genesis chapter 25,